Washington, like, they weren't ready for these new gods. They didn't seem to get put the practice in. And I think losing to Paradigm in the Super Regionals and losing that first seed was actually the best thing that could have happened to the team.
I agree. Sometimes what you need is to lose a game to take a step back and go, hey, we're not unbeatable. We have to kick it back into gear. We have to go back like we wanted to grind to be on the top, and that's how you get back on the top of the leagues again.
Well, it's going to be interesting to see how they pair up. Of course, Isurus Gaming has quite a lot in front of them here, but let's go ahead and toss it over to the stage with Sean.
Thank you so much, Alex. Here we are, game one of the Smite World Championship. Are you guys ready? Now, I have to ask, Owner, are you and your team ready?
Yeah.
Irafer, are you and the boys ready?
Well, there's only one way to find out.
There is indeed one way to find out, ladies and gentlemen. Guys, shake hands. This is it. It's about to go down. We're getting into the first one. Please make some noise. And of course, it's picks and bans time, so that means heading back over to you, gentlemen.
All right, so big thank you there, and saw the players shake hands, get ready to go. You know, I'm sure that they are nervous, but it is time, folks, for the picks and bans of our first matchup of the Smite World Championship between Isurus Gaming and Epsilon Esports. All right, here we go, folks. Go time.
I love the boys of Isurus. They are probably the hungriest team here from just talking to them, from what I've seen, from experience. But this is Epsilon's game. This is Epsilon's like bracket to lose. They are so good, and it's going to be a rough spill for Isurus here.
This game is going to be a matter of how much can hunger get you? How far can hunger take you? Because Isurus wants this more than anybody else, but can it stand up to such a veteran team of Epsilon Esports?
What I'm really looking for is who picks Thor first, really? I mean, are they going to ban adapting Thor because it is his comfort god, it's his go-to one? Do we let this through, or do we try to steal it?
I think Giannis and Thor are going to be really highly contested because both of these teams, I mean, like I said, Isurus, you know, emulated themselves off Epsilon. They love those two picks. Those are either going to be banned or picked immediately from both squads. Isurus's first pick here, they won the coin toss. They took first pick. The question is, are they going to leave both open? Will the other team leave both open? It's really hard to talk about. It's really hard to figure out.
As first pick, then, they do have the room to ban that Thor if they want because they have the option to take the top tier picks as first pick, like Jingxian.
That's true.
Probably what they're going to aim for. So they do have that room for that specific ban, the target ban against a player like it.
It's going to be very interesting to see what they favor, because we know what North America and Europe are always looking to ban and pick, but we don't know exactly what Isurus Gaming wants for their first pick. You know, do they want to favor that Thor, or do they not want to deal with it at all? So it's going to be very interesting to see how that comes down.
They've had months to develop strategies too, specifically for this Epsilon squad, so I really want to know what they're going to come out with. My question to you, Adder, actually, specifically is, where do you feel Chiron lands? Because we saw how powerful Ao Kuang was in last year's. I know you remember it heartbreakingly in game five of the grand finals when you left Ao Kuang open.
Yeah, well, you think you have a counter strategy and then you just don't. But for Chiron specifically, he is a very fun hunter. I'm sure everyone who's played him will agree. His kit is fantastic. Shout outs to whoever designed him. And he's very versatile and all around. And I feel that in his current state of balance, he is up there. You know, he's with the top hunters, but I don't think he's overpowered. I don't think he's really ban worthy unless someone brings out an amazing Chiron play. So I think what we'll end up seeing is, you know, the first hunter who feels comfortable to pick, will take him up, and that'll be that. You know, I think it's not going to be banned, but it'll be, you know, the first hunter who wants it will take it.
The Chiron pick, though, is it does give you an opportunity to put Chiron mid. Chiron's actually a great middle. I know a lot of people have been running it middle. A lot of people actually enjoy it middle. He's got great base damage, good scaling, works, of course, incredibly well with Transcendence, and he works very well in that early lane fights when you have to fight level two of mid harpies. He has one of the strongest fights because you kick people back right towards your jungler, and then you cannot possibly get away.
And that's something to talk about, too, because Europe specifically really likes to run these hunters mids and throw Soul in the Soul lane or Kronos or Freya. In the duo lane, not the solo lane. We know Paradigm love it. Fnatic will run it with Freya. And we know there has been some experimentation with Epsilon. They ran Medusa mid, but that's really the only hunter we've seen Yamen play.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen him play it in ranked or like scrims or anything.
Everyone in Europe likes to play a bit of hunter mid. I know Pretty Prime as well. It's pretty much a thing that all of the top mids do. But Yamen was the only one who did Medusa, which I actually really like because similar to Chiron, she has a very strong level 2. for those first mid camps, in that her three is a, you know, it's the
the last rate,
room,
yeah,
the thing. And it does a lot of base damage, and it scales really well as well. So, you know, I wouldn't be surprised to see the Hunter mid out of Yamen.
Do you think we'll see Medusa, though? Or you think it'll be like a neat
standard?
I hope
we see Medusa, because ADCs don't really play her anymore, and I'm not sure why.
He was phenomenal on it, too.
Exactly, he performed amazing. So I would love to see Yamen on a Medusa or a Hunter, just because it gives him more opportunity to get his name out there. You know, we heard when the names were coming out, everyone cheered for adapting and stuff, and it was a bit quieter for Yamen, and he is a fantastic player. And I think that a god like Medusa would really help get his name out there.
I think those Hunter mids is really going to be dependent, though, on what they want to run in the ADC role. With the popularity of Soul right now, that's a huge reason why ADC's middle have been occurring. So when you have that Soul and that, you know, you have the magical damage ADC role, you got to get your physical damage elsewhere. Otherwise, you're just going to build magical defense. So it depends on their first couple of picks, say, what they pick. If they pick a Freya or a Soul, we're definitely going to be seeing the Hunter in the mid lane.
That's the thing as well, because Soul is a very, she is in ranked at least right now, and at Super Regional, she was a very popular ban, and if you want that magical physical playoff with each other for the ADC, then your options end up being just Freya, because Sol is almost certainly going to get banned. So how comfortable would they be putting Emily 2 on as Freya? I know in the past he's been very good at it, but we've not seen it recently. So
yeah, that was
that
his go-to probably at the beginning of the fall split, but we haven't seen it in a while. Emilito, though, you know, I love Emilito. He's so good, but if there's one player that you're going to get in his head on Epsilon, it's Emilito. That guy, while a phenomenal player, sometimes gets a little tilted, but looks like we're finally picks and bans. Giannis taking away Soul, immediately gone, banned away by Epsilon.
Epsilon Esports does not want to deal with that Soul at all, and Isurus says, well, we're not going to deal with the Chiron right back. So we got those bans coming out quick, as well as the Zeus. We have a lot of magical taken right off the table, and there's the Thor pick. I say take it.
Block
right
it.
Away
this
from
is over Jingxian. Jingxian is still open here, and he had an amazing performance at Super Regionals, and now Epsilon is certainly going to pick
him
up.
Yeah, but do you keep the Thor away from Epsilon, right? I think that's
It's both. I think this is Onur's best god, and it's like grab your best god, take it away from the best player
in the
world.
It's a best
as well.
Of one. You have to. It's like strike now or just regret it forever, essentially.
I think that Thor pick.
Oh,
Bellona. Could possibly be looking towards, but you leave Bellona open.
Had to do it one time.
King 10 open. All these amazing gods are still up on the table. And we might see an early Neath locked in here for Epsilon Esports. Not necessarily a pick they have to lock in here, but it could be a comfort pick.
It's a flex.
This is really interesting, though. You know, I think everyone coming into this was really expecting Shen to be a top pick and top ban, and we're going to pick four.
You know
five,
what it is, though?
He's not here.
I think Epsilon know that Isurus want to run aggro, and if they pick Jing, while phenomenal, takes a little bit longer to get online, is going to get bullied. Yeah, so, but that's the thing, though. Knows they're in the soul lane, isn't going to have a lot of pressure, especially against the Bellona. He's going to be lacking, and that's going to allow Demi to maybe rotate, and if Isra start getting going early, that Bellona's going to counter that.
I would really love them to be looking towards the Kepri here, and they've locked it in. I love that pick. Kepri has a hard time initiating, but when you have a Xing Ten and a Thor on the table to help you initiate, then the Kepri is the perfect defensive support.
So it looks like, based on what we've got so far, Epsilon, you said it's right, Adonis. Epsilon looks to be going for this very early comp. You know, they have pressure in every single lane so far, except for maybe not duo. It depends what they pair with the Kepri. But, you know, if they get these kills on the board, then Isurus is going to have a very tough time bringing this back. They need to really survive until the mid game based on what they've drafted so far.
Sean Quinn, Ymir.
Ban coming out. It's a very strange ban. We don't see that very often in North America or Europe, Ymir ban coming out. But Isurus may have something up their sleeve that they don't want to deal with Ymir for.
I mean, there's, you know, Irafer has played this before as well. And that's a really high pressure dual lane with a lot of kill potential. And if they're running Kepri, well, you know, you can kind of bait out the kill lane at the same time. You don't want to get pushed so far and risk your Hunter dying. They want to keep X safe.
Kepri does have an incredible amount of clear, though, and it's very safe to do it. You can use it from behind your entire wave, practically. So I'm interested to see if they want to go with the aggressive lane here with Kepri. That's what I'm looking towards. I love seeing aggressive lanes with the Kepri. I don't want to see a Shibalanke. I want to see, like, an Anhur, something that comes out and is looking for kills.
I like this Geb lock-in for Irafer. Pretty defensive. He's got a lot of aggro gods, so Denise's gonna be able to pressure that lane regardless. So just pairing the Geb with it is gonna make sure he can keep his carry safe.
This is a very defensive team comp. They've got, you know, they have the pressure in their lanes and stuff, but when it comes to actually team fighting, who are your targets here? You know, all of these have got very strong self-peel or self-defense mechanisms, and then you have a Geb to back it up as well. So it's gonna be interesting to see how Isurus try and break this.
Oh.
As far as the draft is going right now, I'm honestly really enjoying the Isurus comp right now. This comp is incredibly strong, incredibly tanky, with a ton of damage. Plus, you bring out the Huyi to give you that extra penetration on those tanky targets like Bellona. Loving it.
Who do you think right now?
Oh. No, they've run this combo before.
I love this.
They've run this combo before.
This is
excellent.
They ran
this in their regionals, and they destroyed with it.
But this is beads burning, right? This is Thor goes in for the dunk, and then Nox can kill them, or vice versa. Nox pops the beads, and then they go in. Xingxian's going to have his day of ult, so it's going to be fantastic.
All right, well, the Hunbats gets locked in, and we are about to be ready to go, folks. Off the top of your head, Adonis, who do you think came out on top in this draft?
I give it to Isurus, but at the same time, I don't know if their players are as good to pull this off.
All right, folks. Well, we'll see what happens. It is the first game of the Smite World Championship 2016, and we're going to toss it over to our casters.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Smite World Championships 2016. My name is Bart. This is Brandon. And, of course, the one and only Zapman. How are you guys doing?
Zapman made it to Worlds, but Zapman didn't.
Finally made it to Worlds. It sucks to not be playing, but it's great to cast.
Well, yeah, we saw the draft come in. Looking at the compositions here, we heard what the analysts had to say. Generally speaking, Isurus maybe having a little bit more of that defensive, strong frontline composition. And Epsilon, well, it looks like something that they can really kind of nip at the edges, fairly mobile. The Hunbots really sets up nicely with Isis as well, I thought.
I'm just really excited to see Nox played. I mean, she's one of my favorite gods right now in the game. She's super fun to watch. Great beads burning potential. I mean, there's a lot of potential in this comp from Isurus.
Definitely. Just from the picks and bans, you can tell that Isurus has been doing their homework on Epsilon because they took away the Giannis and the Thor from Epsilon,
right,
and they love to run that kind of pick comp.
Yeah, you were mentioning earlier on, right, kind of trying to take away the global composition opportunities from the Epsilon squad, and indeed, Isurus is now going to roll as five down the left side of the map here. And they may run into Epsilon. Looks like Geb's going to see them down this corridor. Not really looking for a pick, looking to dominate the warning game, it appears, from Isurus.
Nothing taken from Nox yet. I don't know what she was going to be looking for. It's probably going to be the cripple.
Yeah, I love the group up by Isurus. It's a best of one, so anything can happen. They were looking for the five-man pick, but they didn't get it.
Yeah, good point there. I mean, like, it is a best of one matchup. So, you know, if you have that pocket strat and you're going up against arguably the best team in the world in Epsilon, it's a good time to see if you can find that early pick, get the early aggression, and they certainly have a composition that's capable of doing so.
If I was Epsilon, I'd be trying to play as safe as possible in the early game. You know, a lot of people are talking about Brazil and LATAM and China coming out with kind of janky strats in the first few minutes, so for them to play safe and just try to play their normal, very talented game, I think is their best scenario.
I think a lot of the action is going to be taking place in mid lane. They both picked really powerful mid-jungle combinations. Nox, Thor is extremely potent, and so is Isis and Hunbots.
You get that stun off from Thor, and then it guarantees the combo from Nox.
That's a ton of damage.
Nox is a high-risk, high-reward style of character, though. I mean, if you miss those spells, she's really, really just out on a limb with nothing much to do. She's a little low on the mana here as well.
Yeah, you could tell that Isurus is going for early game aggression. You see the purple pot by Nox there.
Look at this, starting off strong. And remember, you saw the lack of mana there. She's trying to stack her passive up as early as possible, get a little bit more damage going into lane. I really want to see what we're going to get out of the junglers here. How fast are Adapting and Honor going to get to the lane?
Well, Honor and Adapting, they appear to pick up the orange buff roughly at the same time there. And they'll move, and it'll be a standard start all the way around the map, everyone picking up their buffs. And, well, you're going to see a little bit of Isis versus Nox in the mid lane here because she does not particularly excel in the clear department through the first few levels.
No, what's interesting is that Isis here is going for the left harpies, which is not going to be contested. So that tells me that Epsilon is looking for passive play early.
Which is smart. I mean, you don't want to contest as Isis into Nox. That silence is going to shut down the Wing Gust immediately.
You'll notice there in the top left of your screen, guys, giveaway trigger. First Phoenix that goes down will start a giveaway, similar to what we did on the red carpet. Free chest rolls for everyone that redeems it in the five-minute window that it is active.
Jump. Oh, I thought he was actually going to tag him with that bounce.
Yeah.
That was close.
I don't expect too much action in the dual lane, actually. It's a pretty passive lane. Geb, Neath, they're really just there to clear the wave and get to the late game.
Super safe. Backflip, Geb shield, great clear, even from the tower line. It's going to be pretty difficult for them to deal with. Xingxian, having that Mark of the Vanguard, also going to be pretty hard to deal with. This is the point in the game in which I think he's weakest. He doesn't have great clear. Obviously, Bologna at level 3 is not going to have too much trouble. Nice stop!
Why did he start up that bludgeon so early to Dimmy?
Because he would have got stopped if he
just
went for the background.
Trying to get the last
Xingxian too, the knockup.
But she's still out clearing.
Still out clear with just, the in hands there to the bludgeon. Well, no kills on the board, guys, here. Almost 2 minutes into this game, and it's been, you've heard us say a couple times, it's a fairly passive start. I mean, it's the first game of the tournament.
You know, if it stays like this, if it's passive, I think the game's going to come down to the solo laners. Who's going to have more of an impact? Is it going to be Dimmy on the Bologna, or is it going to be Xingxian?
So yesterday you were talking about how the Death's Toll and Dev's Gloves is not something we're seeing a lot lately, but we see EXT doing that again. Tell us a little bit more about
that. Yeah, you know, it's the tanky meta right now. If he's going to go for Devil Gloves, he's really going to go for that mid-game power spike. Once he finishes his Icarol and his Executioner, he's going to have a ton of damage.
going into, you know, really only the Bologna, though, that's going to be stacking up physical protection on the side of Epsilon. Do you think this is the best option versus, say, the Bluestone?
I mean, I'm not too sure, but...
Do you like Bluestone?
I got nerfed. Destal to me is the better item.
I don't like Bluestone on Huyi.
I build it on everybody.
It's very hard to land those
just
abilities.
Dive at people. It's it's 22 damage. That's great.
Well, here's on her and awareness. They're going to a lot better opportunity to clear there when you have a Thor hammer standing out on top of the Nox darkness. But her wave clear is going to start coming online here soon, and Nox is going to be able to be pretty safe under towers.
Something that I'm interested in is to see how good of a Humbot's ult is adapting it again on his first ult, because I feel like that's going to set the pace of the game for him.
I'd be very scared if I was adapting. You have Red Pot on Thor. You have Purple Pot coming out from Awareness. They have the ward in the mid lane to track, which I love. This early game ward is not seen very often, but I think it's going to be something that's very popular this weekend.
Yeah, I'm actually a little bit surprised that Epsilon would use it in this very first game. I think it belies a little bit of how much they are respecting the Isurus team here. I mean, I think Epsilon going into even some of the European teams from the Pro League wouldn't be coming out with such a safe start.
Yeah, I think what they really respect is the red and purple pod from Nox and Thor. They know they want to be aggressive early, and
so
they're taking away that part of the game from them.
Mid camp's coming up on both sides. It looks like left will belong to red, although Kepri is making a rotation. Awareness rolling as well. It's going to be reset. No mid camps down so far.
Yeah, and there it is, really playing out exactly what Zatman was talking about there. Epsilon perfectly willing to dodge Isurus in these fights and just stay on level. I mean, I think it's the right decision, right? I mean, this is one of the better performing team fighting teams on, well, planet Earth.
Yeah, and I love the rotation by the Huyi. EXT and his teams are really communicating. Mid harpies are up. We're going to go for left harpies, make sure everyone rotates.
Got about a minute left before these potions are down, and I think that's when Epsilon's going to be willing to start taking the fight down. That'll be a 900 gold advantage inherent just because of the potions. Plus, there's somehow 400
right,
gold ahead
exactly
anyway.
What I was going to say. I mean, you'll notice there that Epsilon, this is just an amazingly accomplished and extremely disciplined smite team, and you see that playing out just in the laning phase, pulling out about 500 gold ahead of Isurus. But I think it is also worth noting that that leads like 1,000 or 2,000 against most teams in North America or Europe. So Isurus holding on quite nicely against Epsilon.
So we're getting now, it's almost 5 minutes, obviously no Gold Fury yet. Right side of the map, very quiet. Neither solo laner making rotations. They've been very safe in lane, just going for the wave.
Okay.
Oh, I was wrong. What is this?
So they have the sentry ward down. They realize there's no ward from Isurus and Epsilon. They're going to go ahead and make this aggressive play on the left side of the map. Isis is down, and yeah, that ultimate is going to be enough to secure a Gold Fury in 5 minutes. For Epsilon Gaming.
Extremely smart play by Epsilon. They know they have the Ice Assault, which is one of the best secures of the Gold Fury in the early game. And as soon as they put down the Sentry, they noticed that the jungler was on the right side of the map.
Is there anything better? Is there anything better than the Ice Assault?
No, it's the best.
No, not really. I mean, and I think that maybe this one got over on Isurus, because normally when you see that kind of composition, you're going to see a Bastet or an Emir or a Sobek or some other kind of really exceptional Gold Fury killing god. But on the side of Epsilon, they're able to four-man that there. Raffer tanking it up quite nicely. Amelita, Bluestone, Pennant ticking in. Right when he gets his power boots online, you can see they just go right in and take the Gold Fury, and successful it has been.
Amelito looks like going into the Soul Eater, I guess just running into that tank meta.
Yep. Right?
Very tanky team. And then Isis, of course, damage reduction. Humbot's very mobile. Going to be hard to lock them down.
Yeah, Amelita was really one of the first hunters to bring out this Soul Eater build. And actually, at first, I wasn't blue. I said, why don't you go damage? You need to go damage. But then I started trying it, and it's actually really strong.
So much HP out of that item.
Yeah, 300.
It's a good item.
It is.
Really strong. Even before the nerf, I think it was very underrated. And now that it's, you know, it's become a huge staple.
Well, a big thing that, you know, changed on that item was that it moved from having a lifesteal aura, right? And the lifesteal aura was just not as effective, really, for
right.
your team.
Right.
And also, you know, it's one of the best items on high scaling gods, and needs abilities alone are really high scaling. So he doesn't have to rely on his enhance for damage. He could just rely on Spirit Arrow.
Any chance we see the that kind of power pen based Neath build here?
It could be possible. I'm not too sure if Emelita's really a fan of that.
Oh,
adapting, finds a little bit of trouble, but he's going to turn and burn. Honor's going to go up into the sky. That Neath ultimate already did hit. Not going to be available on her, considering going back in, but no, indeed, he will retreat to the tower. Sees the soul laners rotating over.
Smart play by Honor, because if he would have ulted the Hunbots, the Humbots could have easily jumped it and baited him into a free kill.
Damage coming out. Kepri trying to get away from this one. Dapkin going pretty deep. I don't know if they're going to be able to really lock this one down.
But nice Thor wall is going to disrupt it for now. Kepri's going to revive himself in place. Bettany's still down, though. Hunbots adapting, got a first hit crit there for 201 damage, and that is your Logitech first blood.
That is fear, Bart. Honor was nowhere ready to go in. Nox wouldn't commit either, and poor Kepri just all alone. stuck in the jungle, gets picked off, multiple ultimates used, but first blood, Epsilon is in a really good position. They have Gold Fury, they had a lead, there was two potions wasted on the side of Isurus. This looks good.
Yeah, I'm really glad they just decided to use everything. They use Humbot Salt, Ice Salt, and a lot of people complain, oh, use too many ults for a kill, but guess what? That's first blood, and it sets the pace of the rest of the game.
It's a huge bounty. Plus, shutting Kepri down, making him a little bit squishier than Geb going into the egg game is so important.
Yeah, the thing is, if you start shutting down a support early, they're going to be scared. You know, they're supposed to be this tanky presence, and they won't feel that way if they're getting killed left and right.
This is curious.
Shing Chen, just, hey, you know what? You got an ultimate, might as well use it.
I mean, he got his beads, right? I'm very surprised that Dimmy decided to beads.
Yeah, it's a beads one, yeah, indeed. I mean, well, he's respecting that the Thor is there. I think that the issue is that he doesn't know that the Thor is sitting on basically no mana, probably saw the rotation and thought, hey, I'm in trouble.
Yeah, the reason they do that is because the beads aren't going to be up for 3 minutes. So now, basically, the Shing Ten is telling Thor, hey, you can come gank. You have a 3 minute window to come and gank.
Do you gank Bologna, though?
It's possible with Shing Ten. He has magic
damage. That's true. That's true. Decent damage can shut down her return damage.
Well, but if not Bologna, what lane are you ganking here? Trying to find the Neath then? I mean, she's probably the easiest target, or the Isis. I mean, neither of them having really effective escapes.
Yeah, the Neath is the best target for the Thor. If the Neath backflips, it's very slow. Guarantees the stun into hammer combination.
I'm just excited to see what Epsilon has done here. They've drafted such an incredible comp of just tanky control. They're making sure that they can get Isis into the end game and look for those big bursts onto objectives. I think they're going to be looking to fight under things like towers and Gold Furies for sieges to ensure that Isurus is going to get pushed back little by little, forced to heal, forced to gain their gold back, or mana back rather, and it's going to be hard for them to keep it up considering there's a Geb with the shield, they have Isis with heals, they have adapting to control the front. It's strong.
Yeah, something I would like to see from both teams are different ward placements. You could see each team has wards pretty much on the opposite side of each other. No one's really taken the risk of aggressively counterwarding, actually, up until now.
Oh, look at this.
Oh, EXTT. He's in a little bit of trouble, but hey, drops the stun, stands underneath him. That is one of the major benefits of playing Hoyi. Can place a very defensive ultimate in the early game and can be a nice teamfight disruptor later on.
Yeah, 100% worth it. The Humbot's got, again, beads one. It's another 3 minute cooldown. He might revisit that lane soon.
I would like to see that. I want to see him try to camp this lane down. If they're looking for a win here, taking down Hoyi, I mean, that's their big damage carry. Remember, Nox isn't going to have a way to really confirm a lot of damage in the endgame without help.
And the thing to note, Hoyi, like Neath, is one of the easier gods to gank because he doesn't have any CC immunity built in his kit.
Ooh,
but hey, if you hop over the Cataclysm, that'll do it every time.
Nice. That was really important, too, because Raffer was waiting there for like 40 seconds. That's a lot of lost farm time.
You could definitely tell that EXT is in the zone and he is just locked in.
Both supports now, level 9. Bettany able to catch up because Raffer was looking for that kill for so long. EXTT getting free experience now.
As is sometimes the case, you know, maybe more often than not in Smite, it is the supports that are the captains of each team. Bettany and iRaffer, you see them on the screen right now. Those are your captains from each side.
Now, they can't let another Gold Fury go the way of Epsilon. That's why we're seeing more of a rotation on the left side.
I mean, they have a tremendous amount of wards of Isurus around the Gold Fury, but none of them are sentries.
Control over in the mid lane. It looks like right side camps should go to red here. Will owner go over? No, it looks like it's just going to be a split camp.
I do want to know. I mean, Isurus is playing this very reactionary.
Yeah.
Right? And I mean, and some of that may be due to this continued ward placement here in the mid lane that's keeping really good track of where the bulk of the team is. But I think, you know, with this Thor and Nox combination, we've been saying about how potent it is, they got to get aggressive.
Oh, strange. Bettany, no, going to miss the abduct. Not in a great position here. Amelito sending some damage down. Background wasted the Ice Assault. That could be very important.
Yeah, and then takes a nice chunk of damage out of Awareness. Awareness throws up the ultimate. That's going to slow down Neath just a bit, but this looks like a good opportunity to get aggressive here on the side of Epsilon as they move forward and they swarm through the middle of the map.
Yeah, Isurus saw that adapting wasn't there with his Humbot, so he said, okay, this is our chance to be aggressive. It didn't work out. Kepri missed an ability, and Thor also misses ult.
Good news here, though. Shing Ten does have his Breastplate of Valor plus cooldown boots done.
Look at this.
This is a nice bait coming out on the side of Epsilon. But once again, EXTT, he's going to avoid another big ultimate leaping over with Hoyi. They're going to be able to zone out the rest of Isurus fairly well with Epsilon, but Bologna on the rotation. It'll find Nowzer. Nowzer will find Bologna back. Can they root her? No. Beads are going to be used. The Suns are dropped as well. Dimmy, about half HP. Nowzer out of mana, however, and the rest of Isurus all about 50% on the resources. Honor. Ooh, I don't know about this one. He's rooted by the Neath. He's going to use the Beads. Spear Ball over the wall. Not on the mark. Kepri ultimate has been used, and that'll be enough to force Epsilon back.
Gold Fury still available. We'll see Red start to rotate over and continue to push this advantage.
Yeah, they'll 100% go for the Gold Fury. No alts exist on
Isurus. Is going to try. They're thinking.
I mean,
they have no beads. They have no abilities.
They're going to wipe. I mean, they're going to wipe if they try to go into this.
They're taking too long anyway. This is done.
Take the long way around.
It's another one.
Already going to be completed. You can see the view from Epsilon. EXCT rounds the corner, but a little too late. Yeah.
One of the hardest things to do in Smite is to give away a Gold Fury. You know you got beat, and then you don't want to get beat and lose the gold fury, and right. that kind of draws you into that trap where you start getting snowballed on if you get wiped trying to steal the gold fury.
Emilito continues to farm up, going right to the purple buff. Epsilon leads still at 12 minutes, only one kill up, but the experience and gold are starting to skyrocket. Let's go to the graphs, and we'll show you two gold furies deep, a 4,100 gold lead.
Yeah, I mean, more or less, this is going to be death by a thousand cuts, it looks like, on the side of Isurus. Epsilon just taking little by little, and I mean, you saw it in that early laning phase, about 500 gold advantage coming out of that first five-minute gambit, essentially, and now they're going to continue to extend that lead through objective play.
Yeah, Epsilon is playing their team comp perfectly. They know that Isurus had a better early game. They went the purple and red pot, so they said, okay, we're going to back off. We're going to farm better than them. We're going to look for that early gold fury, which they found with the ice assault, and now they have a good lead.
And now going into this mid-game, oh, hold that thought. Honor, he's going to take a look over here at the right side. He's going to be on the mark with the stun on a Dimmy, but Dimmy, Roma Invicta, out he gets.
The problem there was that Thor didn't realize that Shing Ten DR'd the Bologna. So as soon as he stunned, Dimmy was able to get his ult off right away.
That hurts, right? I mean, he used pretty much everything on that side of the map, and now Emilito knows that he can apply pressure to EXTT and keep the duo lane locked down. And with the Gold Fury being down, the supports don't really want to hover on this side of the map too much, so it's kind of in a weird spot of this one for one. If adapting rotates to duo, this should be a kill.
Epsilon is insanely powerful, like, right this moment. Their power spike has really come online. You have Isis with one of the higher DPS output buildups in the Chronos Pendant and the Pen Boots for Beads 3.
Big
that'll,
fan.
That'll give you two sets of abilities, essentially, in a fight. You have the Stone of Gaia on top of a Sovereignty, on top of a Soul Eater, so all of your frontliners are going to be very, very tanky based on those auras, and just the innate tankiness that Bologna is going to get out of that Stone of Gaia in addition to the regen. Looking at the side of Isurus, they don't have those big, really teamfight altering tier threes up right now in terms of items.
Right, I mean, especially looking at the junglers, Onur doesn't even have his Jotun's Wrath online yet, whereas we look at adapting, he's already got the Jotun's, plus he's got a little bit of crit going as well. So now, what, 35% chance to crit off the ability?
Yeah, the Jotun's is pretty much the staple item on any assassin jungle. If you don't, if the other jungler has it before you, you have to lay back. Can't do anything.
The issue is he can't really lay back anymore. Like Bart said,
1,400 net worth behind.
It has to be reactionary, and he's in a position where he can't not farm.
Yeah, one of the ways. Ooh, here's a fight.
They're just going to put a bunch of damage out onto awareness.
Look at this.
I mean, look how much poke he's going to get. He's poked out. And look at that. Adapting actually misses the overhand smash on purpose to wait out the Kepri ultimate, and down will go the mid laner. What a player.
That is the level of play we're looking at from adapting. That instantaneous decision making, that audible call that he just made to not take the kill and pop the Kepri ult. And by the way, that was another death by a thousand cuts right there. Just little by little, just poking him down until he couldn't do anything. That was another two ultimates.
Oh, they found the leap out of EXCT. No, they got it on startup. He will still have it available. And away he will go, but tier one has fallen, and that is going to be your first tower.
Yeah, you know, as soon as the first tower is down, that's going to start a little bit of the snowball. The Epsilon gets a little bit of global gold, and now they're going to say, hey, we can easily take their towers if we group up. So I think laning phase is probably going to be over from now on.
Those level two beads being down as well. That's almost 2 minutes still that EXTT can be a sitting duck. I want to see more pressure into this side of the map. Keep him locked down. If Emilito can get ahead, you know, Neath versus Ho Yi in the endgame zap, who do you give that to?
Definitely Neath in the early game. Ho Yi can actually kill Neath if he all-ins her, but it's a very risky play and not many hunters would be willing to do that.
Come on.
He's baiting that kill.
I would. You would.
And with another tower down, adapting, nearly getting closer and closer to 2,000 gold ahead of the enemy jungler, a couple levels as well, and a massive item disparity on the Hunter Zapman. What are you seeing there?
Yeah, I mean, when you go Soul Eater, you're kind of weak and have a lot of in-hand damage, and you really start hitting that power spike when you get the Ikaval. Now that Neath has the Ikaval, Hui has no chance.
Right, it completely shreds the damage of the Dev's Glove.
It's a 60 damage split.
Exactly, and that's what he's gaining. So it's going to be an even split. Lifesteal, pretty much even, but until he gets that Ikaval completely online, EXTT's in a bad spot.
It is the ultimate boxing item.
Do you even think that, I mean, I think that I would have maybe even preferred to just see the Executioner come in. I mean, at this point, Hui, he ain't boxing Neath until 25 plus minutes. Should he be going and itemizing a little bit more into the late game, or you know, is it just so compulsory to be able to fight that Neath in lane?
I mean, he could do that, but the Ikaval is so good also because it gives a lot of attack speed.
It's also and very cheap, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's very cheap, a lot of attack speed. Hui's weakest point is that he has no attack speed steroids, so he really needs that item.
Bettany, I think, had a pretty free dodge there, but you still see him use the abduct even under 50% mana. This is showing a little bit of fear. I think Raffer's putting it into him.
Ooh. Yemen's going straight into the Spear of the Magus here on top of the penetration boost. This Isis is going to be doing a tremendous amount of damage. Honor going up. Emilito's going to get caught. Nope. Nope.
Got the double tap. Decent damage, but here comes adapting.
They're going to get the Neath ultimate overhead smash. One more hit will do it, and away he goes, adapting the god. Out he leaves from the tower. Presence of mind.
You know, just I've been casting this game for so long, and in my head, I've seen that play 1,000 times, right? And every
single time, the Humbots never has the jump.
The Humbots always jumps out of the tower into the lane. He jumped like right into the purple buff, and I went, wait, where did he go? It's crazy.
Yeah, Gold Fury started up again here, guys. Let's take a listen in with Epsilon as Nowzer tries to disrupt the Gold Fury.
Nowhere to go.
Well, there you go. You heard it. Epsilon swarms all over Isurus. They try to prevent the third Gold Fury going the way of the boys in blue. And it doesn't look like they're going to be successful with this one. Three members down, plus a Gold Fury going to the side of Epsilon.
Yeah, at this point, Isurus is pretty desperate. They needed to at least try to steal that Gold Fury. It didn't work out.
It was close.
Yeah, it was close. It was close. A good try. They had to do that.
Man, but we have not seen many shutdowns in the history of competitive Smite, where a team has gotten no kills. But so far, it's shaping up that way. Epsilon has a very tanky team. It seems very hard for Isurus to get even someone to have health at this point.
Yeah, I'm really impressed with Epsilon's play. A team of that caliber, usually they're a little bit overconfident, as we have the replay here.
Looking at the intel turning point of the game, this is adapting, diving into the mid lane tower. And what you're looking at, there's the port in over at Smash. Nope, not going to hit him there. They're going to wait out this Kepri ultimate. One more smack should do it. And there it is, adapting.
Do you see him actually getting the third hit of the hit chain,
yes,
too, to make sure he can guarantee
He's
it? And he got it within like
good.
Five frames of that Kepri ult falling off. Like, that is not human ability.
And now a Deathbringer is going to be up for that Hunbots as well. And you saw earlier, three Gold Furies going to the side of Epsilon so far.
Yeah, but back to my point about the way Epsilon is playing, a team of this skill, usually they play a little bit cocky, a little bit, you know.
You would know.
But you could tell Epsilon's just playing their game. They're playing extremely calculated. They're not taking any risks. They really respect Isurus.
By the way, I would have not guessed that Neith was the top player damage this game. 9,200.
Well, she's been tossing out those ultimates. You got to think, this is a game that hasn't had a lot of team fights, hasn't had a lot of 10-man skirmishes, and Neith has gotten, you know, a few hundred damage in every fight based on ability usage, and yeah, she climbs the towers up, not to mention the Bluestone Pendant chipping away at Huyi in the lane.
There go the Suns, trying to keep him locked down. Emilito willing to tank some damage just to ensure he gets more damage on the tower. Trouble here. Cataclysm, still in the beads.
Beads still active, whatever. Yeah, that lasted a long time. And in will come Nowzer here. Raffer in a bit of trouble. He's going to actually like to go back through the tower. Nowzer off the mark with the ultimate, unable to keep him locked in. That could have been their first kill.
I think that was a Heavenly Agility, Bart. I think that's what got him out of there. He just barely outranged it.
You know, Nowzer also had another leap.
Yes.
And he chose not to use it, thinking he had the distance. Maybe he didn't hear the Heavenly Agility.
He does have the E-Staff, however, though, so this is going to be a pretty effective frontline tank for Isurus, but they're going to concede their tier 1 and look to defend at the tier 2. Just off to the right side is Yamen looking for the Spirit Ball to set things up. Emilito's going to find the pin on Abetney. Spirit Ball pending here from Yamen. Here
gotta
it comes.
Go.
It's going to find no one. No, they're going to force out the dash from Nox, however.
We should see an Isis ult here in just a second. We still have the Eagles Rally as well on the side of Epsilon. Isurus trying to hold this down, but they don't have a lot of CC and control outside of what's
been
used.
They have Demi locked down, but they can't burst him underneath the tier 2, even with it pounding into him, and that's a free tier 2 for Epsilon.
Yeah, you can see Isurus' comp, how well it can work and how much damage they can put out. If they were able to do this more in the early game and not fall so far behind, they could have taken this.
I mean, how do you force a team to fight you, though, in the situation where Epsilon's trying to dodge you the whole time? I mean, what adjustment should Isurus, or could they have even made, given their comp?
Instead of splitting the mid-harpies, they should have just mirrored Epsilon's movements in the jungle and try to force the fight that way.
This, to me, is looking very similar to what we saw from Envy and Eager, to the point where Envy is getting decent plays, but Eager was just so far ahead in their set that it just wasn't able to make it happen. Like, they're getting the CC combos off, they're getting the damage off, but at that point, Zap, I'm sure you knew your team was basically invincible. It's the same thing. Like, the way they just comboed Demi under a tier 2 and he laughed it off.
Exactly. The thing is, though, when a team is playing that defensive, the other team has to kind of force the play. So you start seeing these combos from the other team going off.
And look at this. We got a split push cam right now. Z goes for the red buff, takes it by himself. That's another big power spike. He's going Lost Artifact, which means with the Chronos Pendant, I mean, it's not going to be a Doom Orb. He's rushing Rod.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And why not, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, hey, it could be a Doom Orb. Maybe looking to style a little bit.
Yamen?
No, yeah, it's a Ratatouille.
Maybe Demi. I can see Demi going for it.
Well, I mean, he's basically building up the, you know, this is like the ideal itemization if you're a mage. Like, if you can affect this somehow, then you're perfect.
That?
Fire Giant started up. The rest of Isurus, they seem to know that, yes, they do indeed know that it's been started up. They're being zoned up by Geb for the moment. The rest of Epsilon looks like they want to fight. They're going to pull off the Fire Giant. Two beads going to be popped by Demi on the right side. That's going to be EXTT zoned out for now. The fight's continuing underneath the orange buff, and Epsilon is going deep for this one. The Suns are going to be dropped onto Adapting, but Yamin will pick up the kill onto Awareness. Adapting finds EXTT. Nowzer's recalling, and they are conceding the Fire Giant to Epsilon Gaming, now up something like 14,000 golden experience.
It's getting pretty bad, Bart. It's getting to the point now where Epsilon is baiting a, what, 30% Fire Giant for two kills, plus two sets of beads as well. This is going to be impossible for Isurus to really defend. They're going to have to concede this and hope they make mistakes.
Yeah, and Bart, earlier you talked about how you can force someone to fight, and this is one way. They baited the Fire Giant, they had vision control, they forced Isurus into an uncomfortable spot, and they took advantage.
Trouble.
Oh, Bettany.
Trouble.
Look at that, back-to-back, three crits in a row out of Adapting, putting on 1,000 damage into that Kepri. Never mind your Sovereignty and Heartward Amulet, still going to melt. There's the monkey.
There's the 14,000 you were looking for, Bart, there right it there. It's getting closer to 15. It's 14.5 right now as they move towards the final tier two.
Look how fast
in the mid lane.
Bots is going to eclipse Neath in the damage output once he finishes Deathbringer. I mean, he has like tripled his damage output in the last couple of minutes.
Where are we in terms of structure damage, right? I mean, like, does anyone on blue, have they been able to scratch towers on side of the
Zero
right
damage
side?
Delta towers by Isurus.
It's all minions. Oh my God. And look at this, 3,700 coming out from Emilito.
My goodness.
Another Gold Fury. Look, it's like they planned this. It looks like a football play. The way that they're running around the map and every objective's up. We'll go to the graphs. That's another huge spike here. 17,700 for the seemingly undefeatable Epsilon.
Yeah, I expect Epsilon here to back, get all their big items, Deathbringer, Ratatou Hootie, and then they're probably going to push down and win here.
Indeed they will. Ratatou Hootie completed. There's an Iqbal on Bologna giving her some one-on-one solo potential. There's a Titan's Bane plus some physical protection coming out of the bot that'll eventually be the Mail of Renewal. Ratatou Hootie, no, it looks like he's gonna sell off a start and try to finish that while adapting.
I love the pickup by Emilito here. He went for the flat pen with the Brawler's Beat Stick. He really just wants his Spirit Hour to do a ton of damage.
Look at this. I mean, look at just the item charts. You can see like some sixth items getting started or fifth items if you don't count starter items. Over on the left side, there are two tier ones in the fifth item slot. Like, that alone, I think, spells the difference in skill between these two teams. Epsilon really looks like a world championship team today.
Yeah, they look amazing. I love that they just took Isurus so seriously, and they're really just playing their game.
And, you know, like you said before, I almost didn't expect it. You know, and I think that's one of the reasons that TSM and Titan last year had a little bit of trouble with China, is they went in thinking that they weren't going to be as strong.
It, yeah.
Right, and Epsilon treated these people as if they were playing to get here.
I mean, as they should.
More recently, TSM, you know, went into that without mindset against enemy.
That's true.
That's why we have enemy competing here at Worlds. I mean, you know, never underestimate your opponent. They could have boot camps in really, I mean, Steve, maybe you can shed a little light on this. I mean, is it, how often does it happen that a team, you know, is through the regular season or, you know, is performing at one level and then they boot camp and they go into LAN and they perform so much better? I mean, do you feel like every team gets better going into LAN, or what's kind of the process
there?
Yeah,
I mean, you boot camp for the other team, but what really matters is how do players perform in LAN? How do they perform under the pressure, right? If you go in with a solid clean plan like enemy and really just get the right picks and bans, you go in with so much confidence and you can take on anybody.
The Suns are already down two Phoenixes as well, as the chat, I'm sure, is triggered.
They'll have a hard time denying Epsilon here taking this third Phoenix. Seat plan is your giveaway code, guys. Go ahead and put that into Smite. If you are just joining us here, this is game number one of day number one of the Smite World Championships. 25 minutes, nearly 26 in. Two Phoenixes down. Isurus trying to hold out Epsilon Esports.
They don't have enough. They're burning through Xingchen. Adapting, finding another one with EXTT. Bettany goes down three. He doesn't want to go into that. They're looking for the shutdown. 0-12 right now. Isurus trying to fight, but the third burn.